and enter slaughterhouses. Where possible, we have trucks stop and we spend a few moments with the animals. We photograph them, we get footage of them, but most importantly, we look them in the eye and we connect with them. It's an extremely powerful form of activism, not only because it gives you a platform to connect your non-vegan friends and family with the animals that they're eating through social media, but it also strengthens your own convictions and gives you a much stronger drive to help them. So please look us up on Facebook and Instagram, join our group and come along to a vigil and bring your friends and family too. I'm now going to pass you over to Che Neal, the ALQ president, to give you a quick rundown of what else we do at ALQ. Che's been a vegan and an animal rights activist for around 16 years. He's been the president of ALQ for around 7 years and he also runs our Greyhound Racing campaign. Please make him welcome.
Thanks, Amanda. So, as she said, I'm Che Neal. I'm the president of Animal Liberation Queensland. Can you all hear me all right through that?
Yep.
Cool. So, I know you're not here to hear me speak, so I'll keep this brief. After 10 years of being vegetarian, though, I first got involved in animal rights when I moved to Brisbane and went vegan back in 2002. That was 16 years ago now, and a lot has changed. 16 years ago, it was back before Facebook and Instagram, before most social media really, before Earthlings and other powerful documentaries were made, and things have come a long way since then, and the speed of change is just getting faster and faster. Even just a few years ago, it would have been hard to fill a room this size for any type of animal activism related talk. Now we've got multiple animal rights organisations and events. We've got events taking place almost every weekend all around the country. We've got several organisations all working through different channels towards the same goals. And we've got so many great food options. So I believe there's never been a better time to get involved and work together and make serious change in the coming years. But before I finish, I just wanted to let you know a little bit more about Animal Liberation in Queensland. So it was first formed back in 1979, and I think we've come a long way since our humble beginnings. There are other animal liberation groups around the country, in most other cities. We're all separate organisations, but the original Animal Liberation was founded in New South Wales just a few years before Animal Liberation Queensland. And so for a relatively small organisation, funded only by membership and donations from people like you, I think we've had some great successes. Probably our best known success is exposing the horrific practices of live baiting just over 3 years ago now in the greyhound racing industry. It was only through ALQ's undercover investigations and then with thanks to our colleagues at Animals Australia who ran similar investigations in Victoria and New South Wales, that this horrid practice of live baiting was brought to the light on that infamous Four Corners episode. And yeah, while the industry hasn't been banned, there's been major reforms and I think, you know, the terminal damage has been done. And we'll keep working on that campaign until it's ended. But we've also been responsible for at least two councils banning animal circuses. We've been part of the duck shooting alliance that got duck shooting banned in the state back in 2006. We've helped improve laws and educated countless members of the public. And importantly, we've all been an outlet for people to get involved. We've helped educate and inspire countless new vegans and activists. I've been involved with ALQ, as Amanda said, for 7 or 8 years, and I couldn't be prouder to work alongside such an amazing team. We're all volunteers here. This is what we do for fun. We organise events like this. Sometimes there are several events in 24 hours. We run stalls and outreach programs, we run campaigns and investigations, vigils and protests, and we do our best to help people see the truth and make change. And we also do our best to help more people get involved and get active for the animals. I believe Amanda will cover more about volunteer opportunities at the end of the talk today, but make sure if you're inspired tonight to get more active, come speak to one of us or get in touch through email or Facebook.
Okay, I'd now like to introduce you to tonight's speaker. James came into the spotlight as an animal rights activist in 2014 when he embarked on a world first campaign, Voices 365. James took a vow of silence for 1 year, a year that he spent travelling across the country country to raise awareness to the voiceless victims of the animal agriculture industry. He's since been travelling the globe as a full-time animal rights activist. He gives speeches, participates in cubes, marches, vigils and protests, and has gained a following of hundreds of thousands on social media. His videos have been viewed millions of times online, and he's no doubt one of the most influential advocates for animals of our time. He needs no introduction. Please welcome James Aspie.
So many places from the Queensland community all in one spot. So I hope that tonight is going to be inspiring for you all. I hope that we can talk about some things that can help motivate and light a fire and give you some sort of structure or process or something to work on. You know, maybe it's just a small thing that you're going to take from tonight, and that's fine. As long as there's just something that can push you towards either being vegan if you're not already, because we all know, although this is an activist workshop, some of you activists, the activism is to bring your non-vegan friends so they can come and listen to me go on about veganism. Great activism, great activism. So I hope there's something for you and for the activists here who are already here. You know, we all have a different style, we all have a different approach, and there are so many out there and they all work for different reasons and in different ways. I'm just going to talk about my own experiences and what's worked for me and what I think works really well, what has enabled me to reach tens of millions of people with some of my videos and the campaigns that I've succeeded in to reach the mainstream audience, which is sometimes a very hard audience to reach. I'll talk about things like that, I'll talk about approach, I'll talk about specific forms of activism that we can all get involved in and that kind of thing. And if there's any questions at the end, then we can do all that right then. But again, just to start off the bat, I just want to say that it's really inspiring to see so many people here. This is by far, I mean, in my opinion, it's definitely the most important issue of our time. We're talking about billions and billions of animals killed every single day. 8 billion animals roughly every single day, 74 billion a year land, and 2.7 trillion a year sea animals. So we're actually talking about 8 billion murders every single day happening on this planet. And the beauty of it is that you don't have to go to war for it, or at least not at this point. You know, I think maybe one day we'll be going to war over people who don't want to give up their steak. That's actually a possibility. I mean, you know, people love steak. But I think that what we can do as individuals, and that the just through having conversations, just through reaching the heart and minds of people, is so incredibly powerful, can move mountains. And as we just heard, already so much has happened just in the last decade, and even just in the last 5 years, and even just in the last couple of years. It's such an important and powerful time to be a vegan in this not yet vegan world, but in a world that is moving in that direction. It has to move in that direction. We have to make this world a better place for the animals first and foremost, but also for ourselves, because we want somewhere to live where we don't have to go to war over water. We want somewhere to live that the next generation, our children, can grow up and be healthy and sustain themselves. This is such an important issue. It encompasses so much. And as individuals, you, me, together, we can actually make some serious changes in this world and save lives. And so that's how I want you to start thinking about it. You are a warrior for peace. You are part of a revolution, a peaceful revolution, and your role is significant and it matters. And each person that you influence, each seed that you plant makes a difference and can grow into something so incredible. For me, my journey started when someone said to me, eating animals is bad karma. Dude didn't even have a YouTube channel. He just said it to me. Yeah, probably about the internet, this guy. And, you know, since then, tens of millions of people have heard me speak about this, and so many have changed. So So you never know who you're talking to, you never know who you're going to influence, you never know what one of those seeds that you plant is going to sprout into. But I guarantee this, if you don't do anything, then nothing will happen. If you think that this is a waste of time, if you think that it's never going to happen, that's a self-fulfilling prophecy. Your actions won't make anywhere near the same amount of impact as they would if you were doing this with the belief that the world can change. We can have a vegan world. We can end this genocide of these vulnerable, innocent beings. That belief is so important. And I know it feels hard sometimes because you're like this small minority that, this is what it feels like to me, right? I thought about this a few months ago. It's like, you know when you're having a really bad nightmare and there's snakes everywhere? Does anybody have the snake dream? I get the snake dream. The snake, I love animals, but snakes everywhere is a little bit different. And so you're just so scared, right? And then you wake up and that feeling of relief. Oh my God, thank God, that was just a dream. But being vegan is like the total opposite of that, right? Because you wake up and you're like, oh my God, this is a nightmare. This is an actual nightmare happening here right now. And you feel like the only sane person in your family all of a sudden. And you're looking at your family like they're flesh-eating zombies. What the hell is wrong with these people? And you tell them and they're like, I don't care, I don't want to know. You're crazy, you're the extreme one. So it can feel so like alienating and stressful and frustrating. But, you know, I mean, we'll get into it. But basically, I just want to say that we are leaders of light in a world filled with darkness. You know, just to go back on the point I made a minute ago about this being 8 billion lives, 8 billion lives every single day. I was thinking, imagine if there was an alien race and they were watching us and one of the little alien kids had to do a project on Earth. He's like, all right, sweet. So he studies this for a little while, he comes back with his report. And he's like, okay, so I figured out what they do there. And I'm like, okay, what do you do? What do they do on Earth? And he said, well, they cut a lot of throats. They cut a lot of throats all day, every day, in these factories that they built called slaughterhouses. They're just death factories, murder factories, basically. And yeah, what they do is they choose the most vulnerable beings of that planet. They breed them into existence continuously. They separate their babies, they send them to the slaughterhouse, they cut their heads off, and then they all feast on the murder victims while they're patting a specific type of animal or two, saying that they're animal lovers. And that's why I named my project Planet Slaughterhouse, or Planet Throat Slit, or Planet Murder, because really that is one of the biggest things that's happening on this planet today, and almost everybody is ingesting, is consuming the product of this violence. Very few people get it. Isn't that incredible? That was the biggest shock for me when I went vegan. I'm like, cool, I'm vegan. Probably at least 50% of people are, maybe just not my small crowd. What, 1%, maybe, 2%? Are you kidding me? I didn't even really like animals. Why aren't all these animal lovers vegan? I didn't understand at all. That was the biggest shock to me. You know, think about what you know. You know something really special for the people who don't know yet. I'm going to tell you in a minute all about it. But when you go vegan, it's like discovering something that makes all the sense, that was in plain sight on your dinner plate every single day right in front of you, and you never even saw it. And you think, how could I have missed this? Not only how could I have missed this, how could all of society miss this? It's so interesting. It's so fascinating how we've done this, how we built this system based on lies and deception. And it is the most cruel thing happening. It is destroying the planet, and it is bringing so much suffering into this world. So we have to do something about it. Now here's the thing. You know something, you get it, it clicks. Have faith in what you know, have confidence in what you've learned. You don't need to be the most highly intellectual person to make this simple connection that if you are against violence, unnecessary violence, then the first thing you should do is stop consuming animal products, because that's where the vast majority of violence that you're contributing to comes from. Have faith that you're right. Sometimes it feels like, oh, I'm not that confident. Everyone's telling me I'm wrong. They're telling me vegans are crazy. It's not healthy, this and that. have confidence. It's healthier, it's better for the planet, it reduces all this violence. For the people who don't know what veganism is, that was an interesting introduction. Basically what it is this. A vegan is just somebody who doesn't consume animal products. We don't participate in violence towards animals. It's the golden rule. The golden rule is to do to others as you would want done to yourself. And what we've done is extended that not just to other humans, but to all beings. Not just to humans and dogs and dolphins and whales, but also to pigs and cows and chickens and fish. We've extended our circle of compassion to embrace everyone. Everyone. Why not? What's the difference between a chicken and an elephant when it comes to the value of their life? What's the difference? This being does not want to die, does not want to suffer, and neither does the elephant. So basically, we're saying all beings matter, not just the ones that we've deemed special or important, not just humans. We're saying that violence is wrong, and it's not just violence against each other, it's violence above the board. It is deliberately inflicting pain and suffering, misery and death on anyone else. It doesn't matter who it is, what species they are is irrelevant. That violence is wrong. It's unjustified, it's unnecessary in this day and age, and therefore it is immoral. So that's what veganism is. It means we don't eat animal products. We don't eat them, we don't wear them, so we don't wear their skin, basically. You know, this isn't 2,000 years ago when maybe to stay alive we had to cut somebody's skin off their body and wear it. We don't have to do that now. We don't have to wear anybody's skin. We don't have to eat somebody's eggs. And when I say somebody, I'm saying because they're individuals with their own heart and brain. They're a somebody. They're not a thing. They're a somebody. We don't have to eat their eggs. We don't have to drink milk that was made for a baby cow that was stolen from the mother. We don't need to do that anymore. We don't need to test products on animals. We know that if you get shampoo in your eyes, it stinks. Case closed. We don't need to use animals for our entertainment. We don't need to visit places like SeaWorld back down the coast where they're stuck in pools, cages. They're treated as slaves, forced to perform every single day, over and over, in a pool against their will. They do not consent to this. They are taken and forced to perform. This is slavery. This is modern-day slavery happening to other species that we do. And we go there and we don't even realize. Today I saw a video of a lion, and there was this big glass, there's a big glass enclosure, and there was this little girl, like, with her face up, this tiny little girl, and this lion was up there, like, rubbing her head into her. He looked like, get me out of here, and just patting, just trying to, like, make contact with this little girl. She had no idea. And even the funny thing is the adults got no idea. Oh, look at the lion. Not like, oh my God, this prisoner in here. This poor prisoner. Why vegan and not vegetarian? Because all animal products are a product of exploitation. All exploitation is a form of abuse, and all abuse is immoral. Animals are not here for us to use. They are not ours. We do not own them. We do not own their lives, and we do not get to decide how they live or when they die. Once they're here, they're here. They should be left in peace, just like we would want to be left in peace. We just extend our circle of compassion to embrace all beings. That's an Einstein quote. He also said, nothing would benefit human health and our chances for survival on this planet more than the evolution to a vegetarian diet. Now, he was smart, but obviously he didn't get the vegan message. He was now a vegan diet. Back in the day when he said that, vegetarian diet meant a vegan diet, a diet free from all animal. So basically what we're saying is, this is not some extreme thing. Since when did it become extreme to not want to harm animals? That is not extreme. What is extreme is saying that you love animals or that you're against animal cruelty or violence in general, and then paying somebody else to mutilate or torture or slaughter an animal. Even if they don't get mutilated or tortured first, they all end up in a slaughterhouse. So even if you're buying free-range, grass-fed, humanely slaughtered animal products, when they got that knife to the throat, that is not humane. There's no humane way to kill somebody who doesn't want to die. There's no compassionate way to take someone's life. Someone's life is their greatest gift, the most precious gift that any of us will ever have. And to rob that of somebody is inherently cruel and wrong. Just like if I kill somebody in their sleep, a human, and they don't feel a thing, I can't claim humane murder to the judge. I'm going to not just the jail, I'm going to that place. Because I've robbed this individual of their life, and whether they felt it or saw it coming or not, murder is murder. And just because we use the word slaughter for animals, the action is the same. Taking the life of somebody who doesn't want to die. It's murder, just to another species. We can call it slaughter, we can call it murder, we can call it whatever. The action is what we should be talking about. The action of taking someone's life against their will is very, very bad. But it's the most normal thing going on in this world. That's what veganism is. It's not participating any longer. It's realizing that there is a massive atrocity happening right now. And it's saying, I'm not going to take a part in that anymore. It's saying, no, that is not okay with me. I am not a violent, cruel person. Therefore, I want to align my actions with my values, and the least I should do, the least we should do, is to become vegan. Because anything less than being vegan is still participating in unnecessary violence. That's all it is. It's no extreme. You don't have to be an animal lover. I didn't love animals. I love them now because I'm starting to get to understand them more. But when I first started out, I was not an animal lover. You don't need to be a tofu lover. If you love tofu, cool. I love tofu. Get the firm tofu, marinate it in some satay sauce or some soy sauce. It's delicious. I ate a whole block yesterday. You don't have to love tofu. There's many delicious vegan foods. You don't have to be a highly intellectual person. You don't have to be a particular religion. In fact, no religion mandates that we must consume animal products to be a good Christian or a good Catholic or a good Muslim or a good Jew or Hindu or anything. No religion says that. In fact, all religions are based around love, right? Love is the core, you know, to love thy neighbor, thou shalt not kill, etc., etc. There's no asterisk that says thou shalt not kill, except for pigs, cows, chickens, and fish. You know, it's everybody, thou shalt not kill. That's a pretty good commandment. Let's not kill each other, for starters. Put that in the top 10 somewhere. It's a pretty important one. All right. Going vegan is step one, though. Oh, and I just want to say as well, if that's something you want to do, if you're not there already, there's so many. First of all, everybody here would be like, I'll help you do it. Vegans want to help you do it. They're like, man, vegans, all they talk about is veganism. Yeah, but the last time animals getting murdered, it's pretty serious. Like, we're trying to be chill about it. We're trying to talk about it less. Like, it's like really, really important. So we're trying to be chill, man. It's not a chill topic. It's hard to be chill about it. So basically, the first thing you can do is to go to vegankit.com. It'll give you the process. This is what you eat. This is the recipes. This is where you do shopping. This is what you do. And this is where you buy clothes. Like, it's very simple. Most of the time, this is how you be vegan. You go to the same supermarket. You're about to get cow's milk. You have a sudden memory that, oh, recently I realized I'm not actually a baby cow. All you have to do is this. You get the soy milk, rice milk, almond milk, coconut milk, hemp milk, oat milk. Have you seen that section lately?
Yeah.
That's the big section. That's more than normal milk to get anymore. That's too big. All you need to know is don't get the cow's milk. It's not healthy for you. You're not a baby cow. It's meant to make a small cow grow into a massive cow. It's very unhealthy. Alright. So, basically that's it. You go to challenge22.com and someone will mentor you for free how to go vegan. You want questions answered? Boom, they'll answer. You go, I don't know what to eat tonight? Here, what about any of these recipes? You get your questions answered. You get mentored every step of the way for free. You don't have to pay anything. That's the way. Or you can join some of the vegan Facebook groups. You'll have a lot of questions. You'll have a lot of hurdles, which we'll talk about in a minute. And that will help you get through them. And every objection you have that someone answers for you, you're a little bit closer, a little bit easier. It's not hard. The food is incredible. We got vegan burgers. We got vegan ice cream. Pizza, pasta, burritos, nachos. I mean, chocolate, muffins, cakes, everything. We got vegan steak. We got vegan chicken. We got vegan every single thing. Every every single thing that you already enjoy eating, we've got a vegan. We're not giving you any excuses not to do this. We've got it covered. We've got it all covered. Everything. So all you got to do often is just, you go to the same supermarket, you get the vegan schnitzels instead of, you know, the fries vegan schnitzels, or the sanitarium sausages, or the rice milk, or soy milk, or whatever else. We've got you covered. And especially here, especially in Queensland and in Australia, you know, we are spoiled for choice. So don't think you're going to have to, okay, I'm going to go vegan, I know it's the right thing to do, but that means I'm going to have to just eat lettuce and tofu for the rest of my life, and that sucks, but I'll just push through. Nah, you're going to eat amazing food. In fact, personally, I mean, be honest. Don't just say it because I'm saying it and we're trying to like sell veganism right now. Be honest. Be hang up if you enjoy food more now than ever before. Are there any people here that aren't vegan? Maybe not. I know there's at least one or two. There's always a couple. Right? We enjoy it more. Part of that, I think, comes with knowing, well, this didn't kill anybody, this meal. My last one did. That was a pretty serious meal I had. It actually killed somebody. This one just was made of plants. That's a pretty nice upgrade. No one had to get their head cut off. It's a big upgrade. So, okay, that's pretty much it, right? That's it. Don't think of it as a daunting task. Some people go vegan overnight. Some people, it takes them a couple of weeks, a couple of months, whatever it is. However long it takes, whatever. Who cares? I was vegetarian for nearly a year, or maybe just over a year or something, before I went vegan. You know, that was nearly 5 years ago now. So these days, it's set up in a way, we've set it up in a way so that we can make this process easy and fun and enjoyable and delicious and you feel good. Okay, so vegankit.com, challenge22.com, veganeasy.org. Basically, you can just type in, how do I go vegan? And Google will have 25 billion searches waiting, ready for you. That's how you do it. Now, that's step one. That's only step one. Of course we should all just stop participating in violence. That's not a big ask. That's just saying, hey, stop. Okay, this is what it's like, right? There's a dog, you and your friend are punching this dog in the face, hard as you can, abusing this dog. You're enjoying it. You're enjoying it. And then you have this change of heart and you realize, this poor animal is suffering because of me. I don't actually want to do that. I'd rather be a better person than that. So, you know, I'm going to stop hitting that dog. That's going vegan. That's good. But if your friend's still punching the dog, you should really try to stop them punching the dog. You say, I mean, do whatever. There's many tactics. But I would say, hey man, you're actually a really good person, and you see this dog who is suffering so much right now, with their eyes coming out of their head and all the blood, you did that, man. That's because of you. Do you really want to be someone who puts this innocent individual who feels pain and suffers just like you? Do you really want to put them through all that suffering just for your mild enjoyment? Do you know what else we could do? We could go surfing. That's enjoyable. We don't have to hurt anyone here. We could do something more enjoyable that doesn't hurt anybody. And hopefully your friend will be like, that's a really good idea. I don't know why I didn't think of that. And often they'll just be like, shut up. And it takes a few times to be like, hey, listen, I know I talked to you about this a minute ago. You're still doing it though. I think going off to say something wrong and you didn't sink in quite enough there. But basically, I always get this quote wrong. Injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere. Yeah. We need to all do something about it. It can come back to us. There's this really good little quote story thing that I'm not even going to attempt, but basically it's like, they came for this group of people and I didn't say anything because I wasn't one of them. They came for this group of people, I didn't say anything because I was not one of them. And then eventually they came for me and there was no one left to say something for me. So it's about speaking up against injustice everywhere. It's about speaking up for the right thing. It's about using your voice and using what you understand. How you can help create a more peaceful world. That's a really important number one top priority that we should all be making in our life. How can we help reduce violence? Because there's a lot of it. There's a huge amount, and being vegan means you understand a way to do it. How great, how special. What an incredible purpose we all have. What a even if you influence one person to go vegan, just that one individual, you probably add 10, 20 more maybe years to that individual's life, for one. The amount of the ripple effect that comes from that, so many individuals will be affected. And overall, when people are doing this all over the world, we start doing things like bringing the dairy industry down. We bring the egg industry down. We create demand for more vegan products. Things start to actually change in a tangible way that we can see, which is something that is happening right now. People say one person won't make a difference. Yeah, maybe not. We're not talking about one person. We're talking about millions and millions of people. If all of those vegans all around the world stop being vegan, would that make a difference? Yes. And we're just warming up. We are just warming up. We're just getting started. This peaceful revolution, this non-violent revolution, is really just starting to get to that point where it's been like, boom, like it's, and it's going to go, or at least that's what we should be working towards. Who knows what's going to happen? But that's what we should be working towards, that it's going up there. So first things first, stop punching dogs. Stop paying people to kill animals for you. Second thing, help others do the same. This is a gift. This is a gift to share, if for nothing else, because everybody that you reach with this message is going to live a healthier life. Reduce their chances of heart disease, diabetes, obesity, cancers, osteoporosis. In fact, 14 out of 15 of the biggest killers can be reduced or even eliminated in a large part by not consuming animal products. So how do we do it then? Okay, I'm vegan. I want to stop everybody hurting the animals. What do we do? First thing. Because it's hard, right? I remember when I first went vegan and people would ask me questions. What about free range? What about humanely slaughtering animals? And I was thinking, free range? I haven't thought about that yet. So like lots of space. That sounds actually, I can't see a reason why not, but I feel like I read something that told me it was wrong and I agreed with it. It's frustrating. And then you say something and you walk away and you're like, well, I definitely didn't do the animals justice then, did I? Because they're walking away thinking, yeah, actually free range, that vegan told me it isn't as bad. Yeah, that's probably a good thing to do. It is not a good thing to do. So what we need to do is get educated. We need to learn the answers to the most common questions that we get. Because this is the thing. Everybody's got the same all over the world. I've been all over the world talking about this now. Even kids in other countries, like, where do you get protein, butt man? Don't act like you even know what protein is. Don't even know what it is. Where do we get protein? What else do people ask us? What else do they say?
Plants have feelings.
Like, I haven't heard any other. Okay. Plants have feelings. Yeah, what else?
Lions, though.
Lions, man. Lions kill animals. Circle of life, bro.
Calcium.
What about calcium? Yeah. Teeth. I've got canines. Look at these things. These are made to rip into cows. Right? Okay. Yeah. Lions, calcium, free-range, humane, slaughtered plants have feelings. Okay. Now, here's the interesting part about this. It's a long list of objections, often. Some people have 100. There's actually about 100 of them. Some people have 5 or 6, whatever. But the point is, if somebody isn't vegan yet, then they've got objections here. It's too hard, it's too expensive, I'm not going to enjoy the food, it'll make me sick, it's not healthy. A lot of people say to me, I've told them everything. I've told them everything, and they're still not going vegan. Should I call the cops? There's something they don't get. See it like a jigsaw puzzle. There's a piece missing. And until you see it, until you get that piece in there, it's a blurry picture, it's unclear. You know, you need to tune it until, or you need to put that puzzle piece until it's like, oh my God, okay, I'll do it. Yeah, you're right, of course. Some people don't even get to that point though. They get rid of enough objections where going vegan just makes enough sense. Like, okay, there's a couple of pieces missing here, but I'm convinced, I can see what that is. I'm gonna do it, right? Our job is to help move them in that direction. Don't think that your job is to sit down with somebody and make every single person go vegan in one conversation. If you can do that, join me. But that often doesn't happen. That's often not how it happens. It's a process. It takes time. It's about piece after piece after piece after piece. One might happen through this documentary. One might happen through that conversation. One might happen when they try that vegan meal or they see that post on Instagram. Piece, 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 piece. So many objections. Right. Now, these are legitimate objections to people and before they think anything of it. So most people think about, you know, what about protein? That's the first one everybody asks. And it's obvious that they haven't looked into it at all. Not hating on anybody, but I'm just saying that if you just, because I was a personal trainer for 8 years, I thought you needed to eat animal products to be healthy for that whole time. And I thought I knew what I was talking about when it came to health. It's no wonder that there's so many people out there who honestly believe they need to eat meat for protein and dairy for calcium and this and that. That's the propaganda. Where do you get, like, kids think that, you know, dairy, calcium, meat, protein, right? Fish, don't feel pain. This is all part of it. This is all part of the conditioning. And they've done an incredible job at lying to us. They've done an incredible job of making adult humans think they need baby cow growth food. That's what they've done. It's been a great job. They've pumped who knows how much money into it. So much propaganda, so many lies. So of course people are confused and they have these objections. We can get through them. Just like every single person here started with a bunch of objections. They learned this, they learned that. They got through them, and then all that made sense was, okay, I'm going to do it. I'm going to go vegan, or I'm going to start moving in that direction, because that's what makes sense. So let's just go through a few of them right now. When someone says, where do you get protein? Don't be like, protein? Are you kidding me? Do you know how many times I've been asked that today? Look it up, man. Nah, be like, great question. That was my first question too. Yeah, because you don't want to lose your gains, right? Protein is found in all foods, abundantly in the plant kingdom. It's found in every single food. There's protein everywhere. Yes, some foods have more protein than others, but if you're eating enough calories for your body from a variety of just plant foods, you know, you're not just having it from fruit, you're not just having it from oil, you're eating normal meals, right? Sometimes it's burritos, sometimes it is smoothies, sometimes it's spaghetti bolognese with lentils instead of ground cow flesh. Whatever it is, if you're just eating a wide variety of normal plant foods, by default, you're going to get enough protein. You get enough protein. You don't need to worry about it. You don't need a huge amount of protein. You just need enough for your body. And it's not just protein that you need. In fact, plants have it all. Every essential nutrient that you need can be found in plants. In fact, the studies show that vegans who only eat plants have, on average, less nutrient deficiencies than people on a standard diet. Now, there are some things we need to worry about. In fact, mainly there's really one thing, and that is B12. B12 is a vitamin that is made by bacteria in soil or water. We would have been able, back in the day, to get it naturally through a vegan diet, but because of the way we sanitize and transport food these days, it kills most of the natural B12. So what you can do is consume foods that have been fortified with B12, a lot of soy milk, a lot of the vegan meats, for example, nutritional yeast, or what you can do is just have a supplement. Sometimes it's once a week, depending on the dose, the strength, sometimes it's once a day, or just a spray under your tongue. Literally takes, you brush your teeth, one spray, 2 seconds. But it's not just vegans that should be supplementing B12. Studies show that almost 50% of people who consume animal products are also deficient in vitamin B12. Everybody should be supplementing this. Now, a lot of people think that B12 is found in animal products, and it is, but because the animals have also been supplemented with it, either directly with an injection or through their feed. You're filtering the vitamin through somebody else's body first. It would be much more efficient to just take it directly yourself. Same with calcium. We get calcium from a wide range of plant foods, such as dark leafy greens like spinach, kale, or beans, any of the legumes. Calcium is found in high amounts in some of the nut butters, like, what's it called? Tahini. Oh, damn, that stuff is good. With frozen banana, if you haven't tried it. So you don't need to worry about any of the nutrients. In fact, you should be more worried about it now. You ask me, where do I get protein? Where do you get your fiber? Because there's none in any animal products. So also, if you really want to know about protein, just another thing to think about is that the world record holding strongman is a vegan. Mr. Universe of a few years ago is a vegan. World record holding ultra marathon is a vegan. world push-up endurance champion, world record-holding world champion arm wrestler, UFC fighters, wrestlers, football players. And the list goes on and on. The list goes on and on, right? There's so many elite athletes doing this. Now, to be at the top of your game in a physically demanding sport requires proper nutrition. And some of the most physically demanding sports, the people at the top are people eating only plants. They asked about protein. They got a whole mouthful full of information that has got through a lot of things. Protein, okay, we can, they might not have fully erased it from their objections, but we've created a dent. If you think of it like a wall, a big concrete wall, and it says protein on it, you've either cracked it or sometimes you've just obliterated it into dust. Okay. And then we talked about calcium, we talked about other nutrient deficiencies. What we should have also talked about that I forgot is that actually what you're likely to be is much healthier, live a longer life, reduce your chances of all the diseases I mentioned earlier. Boom, so okay, so it's healthier. And athletes do it, so I don't have to worry about that. Boom, and what you're doing is just sort of putting cracks or hopefully bringing them down, all these walls that people have. And on the other side of all those walls is somebody going vegan. When somebody says, what about free range? This is a really good objection. Because that's fairly, you know, you can understand why someone would think that's a good thing. You know, I love animals, that's why I buy free range. That's why I buy mainly slaughtered animals. And so you can start by saying, are you kidding me? You think that just letting them roam free first is nice and then you just cut their head off? You could start like that. What you could also say is, oh, really great that you're such an animal lover. You know, you probably want to know this as well then, is that, you know, I see that you're trying to do a good thing by buying free range, but actually, free range means next to nothing for the animals. It's really just a term used by the industry to make good people, consumers like you and I, feel better about our choices to contribute to something very violent and cruel, something that we would not actually want to contribute to. Don't think of free range as this nice meadow. It's often, instead of being 7 or 8 chickens in one little cage, there's 30,000 chickens in one big cage with all new cruelties, with all new suffering, with all new different things. So free range, they all end up at the same slaughterhouse. The most grass-fed, free-range, organic treated animal still ends up at the same slaughterhouse. And there's no humane way to kill someone who wants to live. You go into humane slaughter. You use a human comparison. What if I humanely slaughter you? Will you be okay with that? You know, anytime you're not sure if something's humane, just put yourself in their situation and go, no, I prefer not to get my throat cut. Yeah, you're right. Yep. It makes sense. So, you know, basically just getting through that, getting through the free range, getting through the humane sort. But it's a really good point that people bring up. And it should be responded to in a way where you assume this person has never heard the other side of the argument. Because most people haven't, or if they have, maybe not in a clear way. And our job is to learn how to deliver that message in a clear way. When someone says, what about plants? Plants feel pain too. You can be like, whoa, you have that much compassion for plants? I aspire to be at your level. That's incredible. You don't even want to hurt plants. You'll be happy to know that going vegan means you're going to save a whole lot of plants from being killed because it takes 6 to 12 times more plants to fatten up animals before the animals are also killed. And if we just redirected a portion of that plant food to other parts of the world, or just kept it in the places where we're importing it from, because often that's the places with the highest prevalence of starvation or malnutrition, we could do huge things for world hunger. In fact, theoretically, we could end it about 13 times, is what I've read about it. But what we're doing, we're taking it, we're giving all this food to these animals, and we're getting back this tiny little bit, because we like the, especially like the taste of this one. Most people don't know this. Most people don't realize that 20,000 children die every single day of starvation. People don't realize that in our world, that's what happens every day. And we're so far off the mark. Learning the answers to these questions might seem daunting. It's not. Practice online. Practice in these debates that you see. You know, don't do it just to be right and to make this other person feel attacked. That's not going to help this person want to go vegan. Do it in a way that's just educational. Hey, I noticed you said this. Actually, what I've learned recently, I used to think that as well. what I've learned recently is that this is actually the case, and here's some proof of that. Maybe you should check that out, you know, because, yeah, I used to believe the same thing, but actually that's not how it is. You know, just sharing it, one human to another, not like vegan versus meat eater, even though some of my videos say that. But you've got to say something to reel them in. But it's like, you know, we're all just family. Like, we're all just fam. We're all just trying to, and the goal should be not to blame and shame, but to inform and explain. The goal should be to lift each other up, to help people do better. Because when you know better, you can do better. And a lot of people don't know any better. So that's where we come in. That's our job as activists, as people who know. That's activism, just talking about it. That's you being an activist. Activism doesn't have to mean that you cover yourself in blood and that you run into a restaurant calling everyone murderers. That's a form of activism. Go for it, if that's what you want to do. You know, there's all forms, right? But you don't have to do that. And I think, for the most part, mainstream people, probably a lot of people here, they don't probably feel comfortable doing that. The good news is you don't have to. I never did that, and I reached a lot of people. And there's a lot of people like me who have reached as many or more who are doing a similar thing. And it's about just learning the objections. So what you can do, you can practice online. I highly recommend that. I did that a lot, especially when I wasn't talking for a year. I was like, well, I guess I'll just do it here. People are like, this isn't working. So you can practice online. You can read the book Eat Like You Care by Gary Francione and Anna Charlton. And that has objection, answer, objection, answer. There's a website called animalrights.com, animal-rights.com. Question, answer, question, answer. All 100 of them. And then there's Bite-Sized Vegans YouTube channel. Every question you could think of, she's answered it for you. Just study it a little bit. Maybe you'll just copy and paste and print out one of those answers each week. You put it where you brush your teeth, you read it a few times, and you practice getting it more concise and sharp. So it's not this big, long-winded spiel about the dairy industry. It's just like, first they forcibly impregnate the cows against their will. Then after a 9-month pregnancy, just like a human, they separate the mothers from the babies, they kidnap them. This causes suffering for the mother because she's a maternal animal, and the children, the kids, the baby cows, they also suffer as well. And then the baby boys are sent to the slaughterhouse, bolt gun to their head, throat slit. You know, the baby girls, they have the same fate as their mother. They're forcibly impregnated as soon as they're old enough. And, you know, well, I'll just tell you, just finish the story so that people here who may not know about the dairy industry, they're forcibly impregnated when they're old enough. That happens yearly, about 4 to 7 years. After they take their babies every single time, they milk them, they take their milk from them, they use them as a milking machine. In nature, they could live 20, 25 years, sometimes even longer. In the dairy industry, it's max of about 7 years until they get to the point where they're so severely used and abused that they are no longer profitable enough for them to keep them around. They send them to the same slaughterhouse as where they killed their babies. And that's dairy, just that carton. So just getting it concise, getting it sharp, just learning the facts. AussieFarms.org is another really good resource for this country. It's got it all. It's got, you can click on chickens, turkeys, cows, pigs. You might feel like, man, I'm busy. You know, I'm busy. Okay, I get it. Like, we're all busy. I'm not saying you have to become a full-time activist, but if you just invest a little bit of time, you know, just initially at least, trying to learn this stuff. You know, you don't need to be highly intelligent or well-educated on this topic to help inspire people to go vegan. Probably what you already know now is probably enough. But the more you know, the better. And when someone asks you something and you don't know, you're like, oh, protein, lentils. I think. If you don't know, then that kind of is like, oh, see? Yeah, nah, you didn't really sell me on that. So they feel like, oh, get out of jail free card kind of thing. Okay, yeah, you didn't know, you're being against, I don't really know what you're doing. And look, that's not your fault. That happens to me sometimes. I don't know every single answer to every single question that anyone is ever going to throw at me. You know, don't put pressure on yourself. Well, I put a little bit of pressure on yourself. But just know that alone, learning the answers to those objections, is the first and biggest step, in my opinion.
What was the YouTube channel?
Bite-Sized Vegan. Incredible woman. Emily is her first name. Her last name is...
Bob.
What is it? So, okay, now let me just say this actually. That is very, very, very important. Getting educated on the topic. You are a vegan ambassador, whether you like it or not. Unless you're a ninja vegan and no one knows you're vegan. But most people probably know definitely that you're vegan. If I'm a vegan show, I'd be like, yeah, you've got a vegan show, you're probably vegan. So, that's a very important part. Equally important, I would say. Equally important. It's not just what you say, but also how you say it. You gotta say it in a certain way. Because, yes, your words can inspire people to become vegan. And unfortunately, yes, your words can push people away from becoming vegan. Yeah, I've seen that quite a lot. Where I just thought, I wish that vegan didn't say anything just then. Because now this person hates vegans just a little bit more. Now we already got a little bit of a bad rep. I don't know why. What's the reputation vegans have? Tell me. Shoving our tears down our throat. Aggressive, preachy, extreme. Hippies, tree huggers. I don't know what's wrong with that. But yeah, what else?
Self-righteous.
Self-righteous, yeah. Pardon? Opinionated, angry, aggressive, preachy, judgmental, tree hugging hippies. Whoa, thanks. That's intense, man. That's the general vibe of what people think of vegans. That we got a lot of work to do. That is a huge wall that people will struggle with. Because what do most people like doing? Same thing everybody else is doing. They don't want to be that person who does something different and then everyone judges them for it. They want to be able to do something and people be like, oh, cool, man, you went vegan, that paid respect. But really, that doesn't happen very much right now. In fact, the only place that happened to me, I was in India a couple of years ago and I got a newspaper article in their newspaper. And I was chilling and then I met these guys, like, what are you doing here? I said, oh, I gave a speech at one of the universities today. I got a newspaper article in the newspaper today. Did you read it? And they're like, no, not really. What was it about? And I started telling them. And they're like, wow. What, no animal products? Oh, can we ask you some questions about that? I was like, really? Yeah. Like, what are we talking about? And I just thought, wow, so much respect for you. I'm like, whoa, I need to live here. This place is amazing. That doesn't really happen. Most of the time, people hear the word. Okay, I'll tell you a perfect example. My YouTube video where I spoke for the first time after a year of vow silence, it's me on Sunrise Morning TV show. And I just say, I took this vow of silence to raise awareness for the voices of this planet, the animals. We all say we love animals, but we're against animal cruelty, etc., etc. And I go into it. I spend a couple of minutes giving a strong vegan message. Peacefully, calmly, respectfully, but strong vegan message. Half the comments under that. It's 3 million views just on my YouTube video of it. It's funny, there's been like another 2 million hit on it just in the last couple of months, actually. There's tens of millions around. So another just quick point while I'm thinking of that is that you might throw a video up now, which we'll talk about soon, that might get 50 views right now, but one day it might get a lot more. That is what actually happens. But okay, so half of the comments on that, oh, I had a lot of respect for this guy until he said that he was a vegan. People actually mean that. As soon as I heard that. A lot of people, not everyone, a lot of people, as soon as they hear the word vegan, shut up. I'm not doing that. I don't want to become one of those people. I have a friend who went vegan. Now they hate everybody. They hate everybody. And they don't eat with their family at dinner anymore. They won't eat with us anymore. You know, that sounds hard. That sounds like something it's quite alienating. And you hate the world all of a sudden. Man, there's so much suffering, so much cruelty. People be like, I already got enough suffering in my own life to, I don't want to add all that, so I'll just keep doing what I'm doing. Like, that sounds really hard. So we got to break this stereotype. It's not real. I've been meeting vegans for the last 4 years, and they're compassionate, loving, peaceful, respectful people. Yeah, there's a few bad apples. And in every group, man, don't tell me there's no bad meat eaters out there, come on. But for the most part, a lot of these people that I've met, and you know, we're trying to do good, we're trying to do better. the stereotype is wrong. I don't know how it got there. Maybe because certain vegans who were, you know, starting this, getting this thing started, really had to be extreme to get seen and noticed. You know, they really had to kind of just drill it in, and the frustration of no one else getting it. And you imagine you just being almost alone. There's no social media vegan groups. Yeah, like there would have been probably a lot of anger coming from that. Okay, but is anger, I mean, is that the best way to draw people in? Like, think about it this way. There's a party happening on your street, and you walk there and check it out, you knock on the door, someone just answers, boom, yes? Is this a party? Like, yeah, it's a party. They're arguing about that over there. They're fighting about this over here. The vaccination debate's going on over here. Come in. There's that part. Like, angry people are aggressive. It's judgmental. Even when you're trying to do good, people are going to put you down. Even when you're trying to be a good activist, people are saying you're not a good enough activist. Activist like this, be a vegan like that. Right? There's all that going on. That's actually going on. You go, I'm not going to this party. There's another party down the street. Open, knock. Yo, what's happening, man? Each other's life and be better people. Delicious vegan burgers over there. And check out, they're good. You can come, we can actually go to a restaurant later on if you want to join us. You know, and look, go pat the dog. There's a whole bunch of rescue animals in there. They love puppies. Go, enjoy. Like, people want to. Unfortunately, I wish it didn't matter. And look, sometimes it doesn't matter. Sometimes some people need to just be backhanded with the vegan message, right? Metaphorically. That's what they need. Some people just need that. And they're like, oh my god, this vegan was like in my face. So I'm just, yeah, it made sense. Most people are going to be like, whoa, vegans are intense. I am not one of them. They are not my people. That's not my tribe. So I was like, unfortunately, but not unfortunately, just about understanding human psychology, just basic. I'm sure you've had the experience yourself with certain things, is understanding that, you know, when we help people feel good, and we help people feel motivated and inspired and encouraged and welcomed and supported and loved, and like they're in this new community and it's a positive thing in their life. If we can make people feel like that instead of judged and defensive and angered and stressed and frustrated and hating everybody all of a sudden, obviously this is going to be a more inviting party, right? So that's our job now. That's our job to be like, okay, this is what everyone thinks of vegans. We're vegan ambassadors. Do we want to keep it this idea that we're all angry, aggressive, annoying, judgmental, preachy, tree-hugging hippies? I don't think that's a good idea. I think we should try to change that. That's what I've been trying to do in my own way this whole time. I never, ever, ever back down on the vegan message. I never don't say what needs to be said. But I just say it in a way that is trying to lift people up. And it doesn't always work, of course. But as Martin Luther King said, love is the only force capable of transforming an enemy into a friend. Whether you think they're your enemy or not, they probably think that you think they're the enemy. You know, and even if you don't feel that. He also said, Martin Luther King also said, the means we use must be as pure as the ends that we seek. Do you want a compassionate world? Do you want a peaceful world where everybody respects each other? Then you have to model that behavior. You have to show how that's done. You have to walk the path. You have to walk it. Walk your talk. Is that right? Yeah, something like that. Walk that way. The good way. You have to walk the talk. I don't know if that's the right thing I'm saying. You have to practice what you preach. Okay? You have to practice. You have to model good behavior. People don't know how to do it. You know, so you look on a comment thread on Facebook, man. No, you know where's worse? YouTube. That place is just a breeding ground for depression and anxiety. Because everyone there is, like, so many people there are so nasty. That's people's full-time job, just to go and make people feel like shit in the comments section on YouTube. That's what people just do. Like, so, but we can lift each other up. Right? We can lift each other up. We can be a light, like a candle, loses nothing from lighting other candles. That's what we should be focusing on doing. So we walk this way, the way that we're asking for compassion, we're asking for respect for all beings. You have to show that to the people. You can't just be grabbing people and be like, show compassion, like, respect everybody. Right? You know, I know what I'm saying. It's so much better. I feel really, people like, whoa. I tried to hassle this vegan the other day, and he just rose above it. He just loved me. I was like, I'm never going vegan. Ha ha, I'm eating lamb for dinner tonight. And that vegan just said to me, well, I hope one day very soon you extend your circle of compassion for all beings, and I'm always here. The door's always open if you ever want help learning how to show a little more respect to these innocent beings who don't deserve to suffer. And the guy's like, damn, man, I want to get into a fight. I'm not here for that. You know, we shouldn't be here for that. We should be here for the animals. We should be thinking about what is best for the animals. It's not about just firing everyone, telling everybody that they're wrong. That's true. They're wrong. But that's not the best way to make them realize that they're wrong and that they should change. You know, we should encourage people, we should inspire people. And and this is just my opinion, I'm just talking through my own personal experience, what I've seen over and over and over again though. You know where one of those arguments is gonna go where someone hassles a vegan and then the vegan bites and then they just fight, and then vegans walk away like frustrated and angry and stressed, and the non-vegan walks away being like, haha, I annoyed that vegan, and vegans suck. That guy was so rude. Doesn't have to be like that. So I'll give you an example. This is the example I always use just because it's the best example. It's a perfect example to illustrate this point. A few years ago when I was in Melbourne, I was giving a speech, and then halfway through, two people walked in. And they sat down and they just glared at me. Glared at me the whole time. I'm like, these people walked into the wrong room or something. I don't know what's going on here. They're not my people for sure. And then at the end of the speech, question and answer came. The man put his hand up, the man and his wife. And he said, that's all well and good, James. What about the farmers? I like that he's a farmer. And I did my best to answer that objection of his. It's a really good objection if you're a farmer. What about us? I said, listen, man, you're not our enemy. We really want to support you guys. We really want you to be doing good as well. We don't want you to suffer. We don't want you to lose out. We want you to thrive. We want you to thrive in business and in life in general. Just not at the expense of anybody else. Not at the expense of the animals. We want to help you with an exit plan. Exit from exploiting animals for money into something more ethical and sustainable. This is a 20-minute conversation. And it got really heated. It got really intense. This guy was like stamping his fingers, going all red. And I'm trying to like just maintain the Buddha vibe. Just trying to be chill. And it was really hard. And the other people in the crowd, so I'm trying to just model the good behavior like that I think works. Trying to model, lead by example, show compassion to this person who is just another victim of society that has taught everybody that it's natural and normal and necessary to kill and eat animals. You know, he's just another, I was that too, a brainwashed victim. That's how I see people now. I don't see people as monsters, animal abusing monsters, psychopaths. I'm just like, oh, you know, how sad. I remember when I didn't think my actions mattered at all and the animals didn't matter and I didn't care either. It's sad, man. The good people are doing that. It's really sad. So this guy, we're talking back and forth. I'm trying to model good behavior. A few vegans in the crowd started being that kind of stereotypical vegan and getting aggressive with this guy. And then I felt the anxiety come. I was like, oh no, man. I started going down to not a good place. I thought, I'm not going to be able to do what I was just doing, being positive and this and that. And then I did a technique that I'm going to talk to you about really soon that I've learned after over a thousand hours of meditation. I did this technique and it brought me to this really peaceful, loving place. And I just paused everything and I said, listen, sir, you're not my enemy. We are here just to try to create a more peaceful world. Animals suffer in places like your facility. And we're trying to bring that to an end because it's totally unnecessary and something that we can avoid. We're trying to create a better future, not just for humans, but for all of us to live. No hate on you. I know this is in your family, generation after generation. We're here to try to help you and help them at the same time. It's not going to be at your expense either. We're going to figure something out for you too. And there are already many projects already in place to help people like this who want to transition from a farm that exploits animals to a farm that makes berries, blueberries, or wind turbine farm, or solar panel farm, or many other options. We went back and forth, back and forth. After I said that, I said, listen, I've got to answer some other questions. It was just being me and you. Next question. How did you stay so calm just then, man? Hey, this is the thing. This is the thing. I'm lucky that I practice so much meditation because it's really, I think it's been one of the most important things in helping me talk about this very, very heavy issue that I'm so passionate about, that's so important in a peaceful, chill way. It's helped me so much. I think that's one of the biggest reasons why I've had some success in spreading this message. Because not just what you say, but the way it's said, the way the message is delivered. Anyway, we talked a bit about it, and then afterwards he came up to me, arms folded, still gruff. What about this, James? What about that, James? And I'm thinking, this guy's got a long list, just like most people. I'm like, well, this is the answer, across the world. This is the answer, across the world. And he looks at me and goes, you've got an answer for everything, don't you, mate? And I was like, yeah. I study. He goes, well, maybe I'll call you later and ask you some more questions. And I go, well, I'll be waiting by the phone there. And then he laughed for the first time. He's like, I've been hating on you. He laughed for the first time. And he shook my hand. I'm like, cool. And then his wife, who was at least as angry, was staring at me too. And I look at her, I'm like, I don't know if she's on board yet. And I look at her, just like, well. And she goes, thank you for opening our eyes to this. This is two dairy farms. Thank you for opening our eyes to this. And I was like, no worries. Whoa, this is real, man. This is real. So this is what happened in the conversation. There's three options. I was staying peaceful. I was staying chill. I'm not going down there. I'm up here, right? And by up here, I'm not a better person. I'm just, the vibe is higher, right? The vibe is of peace and respect. And his vibe was in that particular time, that particular example, condescending and aggressive. He wanted me to fight. I've done the fighting a million times in a million different Facebook posts and in person numerous times as well. He wanted me to go down there so we could have a fight. And I was like, nah, I'm not going down there. That's option one, right? He wants me to go down, so I could. A lot of us do. Sometimes I still do. I'm not perfect. Sometimes I go down there. Option one. Option two, nah. I'm staying up here. You can stay down there if you want, but I'm not playing that game with you. I'm not here to argue. I'm not here to fight with you. I'm not here to try to make you feel like you're a bad person, and I'm not accepting your anger or nothing either. That's all for you, man. If you want to generate that, then you can keep it, because I'm not taking that on. And that's option two. Option three, just like they can bring you down, you can also lift them up. If you stay on that vibe, if you just see it out, sometimes they can start, okay, this isn't really working, this fight isn't really happening. They can join you. This guy just keeps respecting me. He just keeps showing me respect. Oh man, like, what do I do with a person like this? How do you fight a person like that who will not fight you? And he came up. Does that mean that they walked out of there and went, let's go vegan? Nah. Did they go vegan? I have no idea. Probably not. Probably not, if I'm honest. But they didn't walk out of there like this. Vegans. I knew it. I hate them. They're our enemy. Did you hear how that guy talked to me? They don't respect us at all. He didn't do that. They walked out of there like, well, that was unexpectedly interesting. Yeah, that vegan was a nice guy, wasn't he? Yeah. And he had a lot of good points. I know. Talk about this. Like, they walked out of there with a good feeling in their mouth. And if all that happened is that we helped, in that time, we helped improve the general vibe of being a vegan, of what a vegan is, that's great. That's a great crack in a very, very strong wall. A very important wall that we need to break down. So when people think, oh, I want to go vegan, instead of people being like, you got to go vegan? Do you know what vegans are like? They'd be like, cool, man, I respect that. That's actually really cool. I know a lot of really cool vegans. Yeah, I'll get you in touch with somebody. Yeah, I'd like to go vegan. I'm working on it. Whatever. Like, that's the vibe that we should be creating, which we are, which we're working on. But just something really to think about, because delivery, how you say it, lifting people up. You know, and remembering, like, this is so important. Everyone goes vegan, and then it's like, you know, straight away, oh, animal abusing scum murderers. I calmed down, yeah, just like 2 weeks ago. You know, like, but it's because you wake up and everything's different when it clicks. Everything changes. But until that point, you know, you're just one of them. And we were all there. We were all there. I'm so grateful. So grateful. It's one of the best things that ever happened to me, that I learned about what I was participating in and that I had the means to be able to end my participation and also help others to end theirs as well. I'm so grateful for that. It's so good. So, yeah, when we talk to people, let's keep it in mind that we were there not that long ago. Put yourself in those shoes. Remember what it was like. Be the vegan that you wish spoke to you when you were vegan, before you were vegan. Be the kind of vegan that you wish you met before you were vegan. That's really good advice. I'm glad no vegan came out to me hassling me and hounding me, and I don't know, maybe it would have worked, but I know what definitely worked. People just handling my objections, and I know that worked because I've done it over and over, and it works even with people like that. Dairy farms, it helps. That's it. Doesn't mean your job is not to sit down with someone, remember, and make them go vegan. Don't make that your job. Your job is to plant seeds and help them grow. Your job is to just put a piece, put as many pieces as you can. But, okay, let's say someone gives you 5 minutes. Someone gives you 5 minutes of your time. Spend some of that time creating rapport. Spend some of that time finding common ground. Spend some of that time just asking about them. You know, like, be cool, man. Be socially aware with this person. If they think you're just another preacher on the street preaching something and selling something and here's a brochure, like, nah, but if they see that you're a real person and also you've got a really quite important message, that's a really good way to do it. So, yeah, just be that vegan that you wish that you met before that you were vegan. And some of the quotes that helped me do this, because it's, I'm saying, like, just everyone just go out there and be chill. And then as soon as you get out there, someone's going to say something. You're like, I just lost my chill instantly. There's a few things that helped me do that. Quotes are so helpful for me. I think they're helpful for a lot of people. Forgive them for they don't know what they do. Most people have no idea what they're contributing to. They're just contributing to it. They're just born doing it. They had lamb as baby food, mashed up lamb. You know, like, that's baby food. Babies eating babies. That's what's happening. You don't ever make a conscious decision, hey, look, you can eat this way, killing heaps of animals, or you can eat this way, just eating plants. We don't do that. We just start eating chicken. And then one day we might ask, is this a real chicken, Mum? And Mum's like, nah, it's just from the shelf, remember? Oh, yeah. So this is instilled in us, but it can be something that we, yeah, just be aware of it, just be aware of it. I actually can't remember what I was saying. I completely forget what I was saying. Like, I was on a massive roll there. I was due to forget. Okay, so anyway, we'll move on from that. How you say it? So, that's right, I was talking about quotes. No one invited me. We don't know what's going on either. Quote number one, forgive them for they don't know what they do. Quote number two. Okay, I'm just going to give you a bunch, actually. Forgive them for they don't know what they do. Hate the sin, love the sinner. With this dairy farmer saying, listen, I respect you, man. I love you, man. I respect you, my brother, the Phoenician brother, you know, or whatever. I respect you, of course. You're such a good person because of this and because of that and because of this and because of that. But this, I do not respect. How could I respect that? How could you ask me to respect you knowingly contributing to so much suffering and killing? No, I cannot respect that. I respect you, but that is wrong. And I'll always be real about that. I'll never sacrifice the message just to be nice to someone. You can be nice to someone, but still be real about what you believe. Hate the sin, but love the sinner. Forgive them, don't know what they do. Be the change you wish to see in the world. Gandhi quote, show. Be compassionate, man. And there's one more. Oh, yeah, the one that I already said, but I'll say it again. Don't blame and shame, inform and explain. Yeah, just always make your goal to give them a little more information, to cross a little bit more off their lists. And those three things help me a lot. Those three things help me a you have to know why they do. Yeah, just remembering that, this is the world we live in where this has been so normalized, this violence has been so normalized. Just keeping that in mind. And when you're talking to people, realizing that they're not these animal abusing, psychotic murderers who just thrive on abusing animals. No, it's good people like your mum and your dad and your brother and your sister just taught to do something very wrong by a very powerful industry. So yeah, there's a few things. Okay, now a little bit more specific about how do we get this message out there? You've got the information, you've got it down pat, how do you say it? How do we get it out there? There's a lot of good ways now. I mean, first and foremost, social media should be utilized by every single person here. Even if all you have is 200 friends on your Facebook, a couple of hundred on your Instagram, that's a lot of people. Compared to when we didn't have that, wow, isn't that amazing? You can get thousands. You can be consistent and get thousands and thousands and 100,000 people following you if you follow certain tips in terms of consistency. Okay, I'll give you a few specific tips. Let's say you're using Instagram. You do your photos. In fact, all social media photos should be long for the most part because people scroll in a long way. So these little ones across like that, people aren't zooming in like that. They're just looking at the big photo. That helps a surprising amount, making long photos. Do all the filters. Make it look good. The point is to make it visually appealing. Who cares if it's that's not really the color of this so much. Who cares, man? What you want is people to interact with it. So do whatever you got to do to make it something that people think, oh, that looks good. Like it's very visual, for example, Instagram. Sometimes your captions should be short and sweet. Love animals, don't kill and eat them. Sometimes they should be long. Here's the whole vegan message, all about the nutrients that you'll get and how much healthier it is, this and that. Sometimes you should post this is my opinion. Sometimes, occasionally, you should put graphic stuff. Sometimes you should put delicious vegan meal. Sometimes you're just chilling at a waterfall. Sometimes you're just doing something really mundane. This is a book I'm reading. Totally got nothing to do with it. Look, this is me and my friend hanging out. This is a concert we went to. Slaughterhouse footage. If you're doing that every single day, even vegans aren't going to want to follow you. Vegans don't want to follow. Keep it, mix it up, man. If you're just doing the vegan message all the time, vegans might enjoy it. You got a lot of pats on the back. Good job. Lots of good vegan messages. But if the only people that are reading it are vegan, that's not really great. It's not reaching the target crowd unless you're just specifically talking about activism, in which case, okay, fair enough. But basically, yeah, you've got to think about what does the general public want to see, or what do my friends and family want to see? They want to see you being a normal person. They want to see you enjoying your life. They want to see you being happy. They want to see what you're passionate about. But not every single message, every single time, every single post. You know, that in my opinion, for the most part, is going to turn people away and make it seem like you're part of a cult or some sort of extreme, like full-on thing where that's all, as soon as you go vegan, that's all you talk about. And don't feel bad if you're doing that. Like I'm not saying you shouldn't be talking about veganism, like, of course. But I'm just saying that having the balance is smart. It's being strategic. When I first learned that, I was at a time where I was just pumping out the graphic stuff and like blame and shame. If you buy dairy, this is your fault. And like, it was intense. And I noticed people that used to follow me started liking my posts less. All the vegans were like, great, great post. Thanks a lot, I know, right? Cool. And then I met someone who's got a very large social media following who's a vegan. So how did you get that? She said, well, I looked at your stuff. Who do you think is going to enjoy looking at this? I'm like, hopefully a few vegans. She's like, yeah, and that's it. I was like, yeah, you're right. I need to post more just about me and about doing things. I don't know. I don't even do things anymore. I'm going to have to start doing things again. So people think I'm wrong. God, now I forget how to do that. But that's smart because, you know, we want to create content that other people can, that anyone can enjoy, and when they you know, when they start paying a little bit more attention to the things we post, occasionally they're going to get a seed planted. Oh, there's a little vegan message in that one. Oh, whoa, that burger looked pretty good. You know, whoa, I saw that. Did you see that footage you posted a couple of weeks ago? Yeah, that was pretty intense. you know, people are more inclined to interact. In terms of consistency, I think it's great to post every single day, once a day, once or twice a day. Any more than that, and it gets a little bit much. And occasionally just have a day off. So people are like, oh, I didn't post today. I hopefully post tomorrow. And then they say, like, here's another, maybe. But I think that's a good amount. From trial and error, I think that once a day is a great amount. That's easy. That's not hard. Take a photo of something cool. Or just go on spend a few hours one day just saving a whole bunch of stuff from a wide range of things. Positive quotes, inspirational people, good recipes, the footage, or the photos, the great stuff, whatever. And then you can just have a library where, okay, so when I this, I'll post Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, just do it daily, whatever. But the point is to realize, whoa, you have something in your pocket that you can pull out and just go, boom, 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 here's my thoughts, boom. And then maybe 200, maybe 50 people read it. That's 50 people. You know, that's still very significant. Don't think, oh, I don't have a million followers, so what's the point? Do you have 100? Most people do. That's great. And if you're posting consistently, you're probably going to get more. And here's another thing. We should all be supporting each other's work. We should all be, when it pops up, just like it. Even if you didn't really read it, who cares? If you know they're vegan and they're trying to spread their message, like, share, you know, share. Not too much, but show some support. It's a fine line, guys. It's a dance. Show some support for people so that, you know, people see that it's being interacted with, and basically just, yeah, work on that. If you're making videos, I mean, that's in my opinion, as of recently, I've decided that's probably, well, I'd say it's probably the most important thing, if you can get into that. And it can just be your thoughts, or it can just be this meal or that recipe, or just sharing other people's stuff, if you're not really comfortable behind a camera or whatever else. But people love seeing and hearing and distracting themselves from their own life. Like, oh, I don't want to do that thing. Is there anything I can watch that seems semi-interesting? Oh, good, there we go. You know, like, that's just what we want to do. So I think that's a really good thing to do. But that's just like social media stuff, and I can't stress enough how huge that can be. You could make a video that one of my speeches had 13 million views. Like, that's, do you know how long that would take me if I was doing speech to speech? Like 10 lifetimes or something. So yeah, you never know when that's gonna happen. When something you write with a certain photo, when you walked past a dog or a cow and you thought of something and you wrote it, could get shared. Doesn't matter who you are, and really get a massive reach. And there, that's like, whoa, a million seeds planted, or even just, whoa, 300 seeds planted. And that all helps push this world in that direction. Like, that's us doing our part with something as simple as just going, cool, done my activism. Like, wow, how great, what a great tool we have. What a great tool we should all be utilizing in the way that we're talking about. Compassionate, respectful, modeling the good behavior. That's one thing. Now, what else can we put on there? All the actions that we do. I'll be a little bit specific with direct vegan activism, and then we'll talk about more kind of subtle or other ways. Three things, main groups happening right now: Anonymous for the Voiceless, the Save Movement, and Direct Action Everywhere. Anonymous for the Voiceless, if you don't already know, it is a worldwide movement where groups of people in different cities around the world, they set up a demonstration in somewhere like a public place, a popular place. They have activists standing in a square, all facing out, holding laptops or holding TVs, masks on their face because it's not about the activists. And the TVs or the laptops show graphic cruelty. Then we have people doing outreach. So basically the thing is, we've got this thing going on, what's that? People come over, they watch, they have a look at it, and then one of the outreaches will come up and go, hey, go on, man, what do you think of this footage? It's pretty intense, isn't it? Have you ever seen anything like this before? Oh, no, I haven't really. Okay, well, what we're showing is everything that happens to animals before they become that neatly wrapped package on the supermarket shelf. Oh, yeah, but that doesn't happen in Australia. Well, actually, everything we're showing is standard legal practice of what happens in Australia. You go to Woolworths, that's where it came from, for example, right? And then we get into these conversations with willing participants who came over who were interested. You can extend that reach by having a microphone on and having someone record that conversation. And you can, I mean, it's up to you if you want to say, hey, is it okay if we record this conversation? Or you can just be like, hey, how's it going? Whatever. some of those videos will reach 100 people, 100,000 people, who knows? Depends on the conversation and how interesting it is to the general public. So that's Anonymous for the Voices. It's already happening in Brisbane, in Gold Coast, Sydney, all around Australia, all around the world. You can either join that already existing cube or start another cube somewhere else. You don't need many people to do it. You need a small group. It's inexpensive. It takes a couple of hours of your time, once a week, hopefully twice a week, a few times a week, whatever you can dedicate. But then you're seeing real tangible results when you're having conversations and you're educating people. Or if you're not comfortable educating or talking to people, cool. Someone needs to be holding that laptop. Someone needs to have that mask. Someone needs to organize it. Whatever it is. Someone needs to drive people there, maybe. Sometimes, yeah, there needs to be vegan food. Maybe some people want to make some cupcakes or donate food. Or who knows? There's lots of little different ways. That's Anonymous for the Voices. That's an extremely powerful form of activism that anyone can do. You know, you don't have to be anything special. As long as you know a little more than the average person on the street, which every vegan does, then you're going to have some good results. And for the people who don't really, you know, sometimes you say something like, oh God, like I messed it up, cool, next, who cares, there's more people going to come. And it's not like on the internet, people don't walk past and like, bacon! Actually, that's happened a couple times. It's all chill. It's fine. It's good. And then after that, you're like, man, I feel so good. Like, I impacted people today. I spoke up for those animals today. I helped today. I helped move this thing forward today. Well, didn't cost me anything. It took a couple of hours. It's great. And you meet some really cool people there. That's Anonymous for the Voices. You want to get involved, you can easily find Anonymous for the Voices, Brisbane chapter, or if you live from somewhere else, find or create your own. The Save Movement. We've got a vigil happening tomorrow at
JBS.
Don't tell them. JBS. Okay, it's a slaughterhouse. So the Save Movement is about bearing witness. It is about going to a place where animals get killed. We stand out the front. We don't go in. We don't break the law. As the trucks come, truck after truck, full of animals. Okay, we break the law a little bit. Stop the trucks. A little bit. Like if you're walking slowly across the road, what? That's not breaking the law. You've got to stop. You stop and drive. But sometimes you can create, I mean, often, after a while, they get sick of us being there and they're like, let's just make a deal. We'll give you 2 minutes with the trucks. Perfect. That's more than enough time. Often, it gets to the point where, okay, we got a sign, no hate for truck drivers. We are just here to say goodbye to the animals. Something that you said that I just slightly disagreed with or thought a little bit differently, and maybe you're just talking and didn't think about it, but you said, the main thing we're there for is to engage with the animals. You said, we're there to take footage of these animals, the main thing is to engage with the animals. I think it's great to engage with the animals, but me personally, I'm not really there to engage with the animals. I'm there for the footage. I'm there to share this with everybody else. Like, you know, I'd like to give them a little bit of time or whatever and give them some love, and I try to do that. But main goal is everyone needs to see this, and it's the sweet spot. It's not a sanctuary. It's like, oh, look at these sweet little lambs, look at these cute pigs, oh, look how funny they're being. That's a bit, like, that's good, that's powerful as well. But it's not really telling the story of what the issue is. You know, you can tell the story, oh, they're rescued, this and that, but it doesn't really illustrate it well. And it's not the slaughterhouse where they're in the gas chambers thrashing, screaming, getting their throat cut open, where a lot of people are like, I can't watch that, don't ever show me that again. If you share that again, I'm blocking you on Facebook. Like, that's what people do. It's that sweet spot in the middle where people are like, whoa, my friend is there, my family member is there. They're posting on their Instagram or on their Facebook, they're live streaming, whatever they're doing. They're at a slaughterhouse right now. A truck full of animals came. Did you see them? I'm like this, like, we're in there getting footage of their eyes. They're looking at us, they're licking our hands, and then the truck drives off. Gates close, and then you can say, those animals right now are going to be gassed to death, they're going to thrash and scream and suffer in pain, and then people are going to eat their dead bodies, and they're going to buy them at the supermarket, and they're not going to think anything of it, and you know, whatever, you tell the story, you tell it how it is. That's such powerful form of activism. Out of everything I share online, the most engagement from people all over. Yeah, another thing that you want on Instagram is ideally bigger accounts to share your stuff. But a lot of big accounts aren't big and active, so they don't want to share intense stuff. But what I've noticed is they're happy to share your visual, your experience at the visual. Because again, it's that sweet spot. It tells a story in a very impactful way without all the graphic violence and traumatizing footage. That's the Save Movement. We got one tomorrow. It's at JBS, which I don't know where that is, and it's at 8 a.m. Look it up. Come. Don't think, oh, there's already 30 people going. Let's get 300 people there. Imagine if every slaughterhouse vigil, we had 300 people. People would start taking it a lot more seriously. 300 people, 400 people, 500 people. We just all come together. Just do it. Just get the footage. We're all there. We're talking about it to each other. We're online. We're doing it. Good. Then we go. Just a couple hours of your time. Doesn't take a lot, but that the power of that, man, it's so impactful. And when we get big numbers like that, the media get involved, the police get involved, we have conversations with them, we have conversations with the media, we reach the mainstream. We need people there. We need everybody there. We need every vegan there to be active. Just do it, because even if you don't do any of the social media stuff, even if you don't want to look at the animals, just the power in numbers, just showing that we are a force to be reckoned with. And we're serious and we're not backing down. And we'll be here every week, every single week, and we're going to grow in numbers every single week. Wow, like that's a statement. That's an important statement to make. Third thing, direct action everywhere. This is a group which do disruptions. They go into, let's say, Woolworths, and they hold signs that says something like,
it's not food.
It's not food, thank you. It's not food, it's violence. And they'll stand there in front of the meat section. It's not food, it's violence. Sometimes they just stand there. And they're disrupting the normality of the morgue section. They're disrupted. People are standing, they're going to buy their meat, and they're like, it's not food, it's violence. And they picture an animal, and then they're like, okay. You know, they just help them make that connection. Sometimes it's serious. Well, it's always serious, but sometimes it's like intense, where they're chanting, it's not food, it's violence. They're saying, their bodies, not ours. Their milk, not ours, you know, and it's like, it's intense, like, wow, it is a disruption of the normal, and a really good form of activism. Me personally, I don't really get involved in that. You're free to pick and choose whatever you want to do. Don't think like you have to do everything. The reason why I don't do that is because one of the things I think is important for me personally as an activist is to be as relatable to the mainstream as possible. And I think that if I'm doing that kind of disruption, I'll lose some of that relatability with a lot of my audience. So I personally avoid that. But does that mean I don't support it? No, I support it. I support it if it's done in a good way. And sometimes it's not. And sometimes slaughterhouse rituals go bad, and sometimes outrages at the cube are aggressive or whatever. But I support the idea behind it, and I support it if it's done in a good way, and many times it is. If that resonates with you, that's another opportunity for you to get involved and do, and that's something happening in Brisbane as well, I'm pretty sure, right? Yeah. Sweet. Okay, there are three of the main things. I mean, okay, now they're specific, direct, vegan activism. On top of all that, no matter what you do, no matter who you are, no matter what skills you've got, you can spread the vegan message. You can paint pictures that spread the vegan message. You can write songs and do music. You might be good at creating web pages. You can create web pages for organizations, for activists. You can host things like this where a bunch of people come and listen to someone speak or a documentary showing. You can be the speaker. You can create the documentary. You can be the filmer. You can be the narrator. You can, if you are interested in creating recipes, you can make vegan recipes. You can open a vegan cafe. What else? You can just talk to your friends. You can just make food for other people. I mean, what else? Like, you can, if you're a designer, you can create t-shirts or logos or cool pictures or stickers. You can just get those eating, it says eating animals in red. And you've got stop signs, you just put it at the bottom, stop eating animals. You can use chalk and do big messages that in a popular place where people see it all the time. I mean, no matter what your strength is, no matter what your skill is, no matter matter what you're trained to be. If you're an athlete, you're some sort of athlete, you can prove that plants are good enough to get you across the finish line. Me personally, something anxiety, I didn't talk for a whole year, hoping that it would be interesting enough for people to pay attention, and it worked. I cycled 5,000 kilometers across Australia to break that weak, sickly, vegan stereotype, and I got tattooed for 25 hours straight, again thinking that it would be something interesting that people, a different crowd of people, might be interested in. And I did that to raise money for different charities. There are just a few kind of random ideas that really had nothing to do with veganism, but I made them have something to do with veganism. So you can just wear a t-shirt. Sometimes I don't wear vegan shirts at all. I don't, because if I'm going to talk about veganism for an hour, I kind of feel like the shirt's a little bit redundant and overkill. But I don't wear it. Sometimes I don't wear it. Sometimes I just want to blend in and people be like, oh, you're vegan? I had no idea. Sometimes I want to walk down the street and be like, you know, show up. So, whatever. Sometimes, you know, whatever you feel. But just remember that it's on us. It is on each and every one of us. Don't expect some other activist to do it. Don't expect some other group to do it. If you're vegan, it's on you. The whole thing isn't on you. We share the burden on all of our shoulders, but we all play a part. We're all part of this, and we all have the responsibility to do something. Einstein said, those who have the privilege to know have the duty to act. That's all of our duty. Now, I'm glad I just remembered this because I was just about to finish and I remembered I was going to do something that I just remembered I was going to do it. So I mentioned earlier that there was a technique that helps me stay peaceful and calm and come from that good place. I'll tell you a little bit about it, and if you want, anyone who wants it, we can practice it together just for a couple of minutes if anyone's willing. I think it's a really, you know, it's great to hear about it, but even better to actually experience it so that you know it for yourself rather than me just saying it's really good. And what it is, it's a technique I learned at a meditation course called Vipassana. Vipassana is a 10-day meditation course where you meditate 10 hours a day for 10 days. You don't speak, you don't look at people, you just sit on the cushion and you just, all your demons come up. And it's very uncomfortable. No matter how you prop up your 12 different cushions trying to sit on your throne, doesn't matter. The discomfort comes no matter what you do. Discomfort's going to come. Being a vegan and not yet being involved, but just being a human in general. An example would be talking to those farmers. Had my speech. What I did when I started feeling that anxiety, I'll tell you. First, I'll tell you what we usually do. What we're, most of us are in the habit of doing. When something uncomfortable happens, we either do one of two things. One is we resist it. So let's say that anxiety came, and this is what initially happened. The anxiety came, and I'm like, oh no. Getting anxious. I don't want to feel like this, not right now. I'm not in front of a big crowd of people. I don't want this to happen right now. And I'm fighting it and fighting it and fighting it. And what I'm doing is just adding another layer of stress to an already stressful situation. I'm resisting something that is. There's no point, it's here, and I'm saying, you shouldn't be here. It's here, man. It's happening. So why resist? But that's what we often do. We wish it was another way. We don't accept the moment as it is. The other thing that we do is we avoid it. We run. Oh, something uncomfortable. Where's the drugs? Where's the alcohol? Where's the TV? Let me get some food into me. Can I just call someone and just talk about something else? Often we avoid it. And both of those things are teaching us that we can't handle it. They're teaching us, if you're trying to resist it, oh, you mustn't be able to deal with it. If you're trying to avoid it, oh, you mustn't be able to deal with it. And so, next time when it comes, we go back into that habit, and that is like a shadow that looms over us. But if we just turned around and looked at it, we'd realize it was a tiny little thing with a flashlight behind it creating a huge shadow. And what I mean by that is, instead of resisting and instead of avoiding, you face it head on. When this discomfort comes up, when you're having a conversation with somebody, if there's anxiety, if there's anger, if there's frustration, as soon as you realize that something like that is happening, you don't run, you don't resist, you observe it. You go in there, and that to do that, it's like this. Okay, what is happening in my body? Where is this? If it's anger, you might feel tense, tension in the chest, you might feel heat. You're observing the physical sensations of what's going on. Physical sensations is very important. So where's the tension? So when I had that anxiety, it was in my chest. I felt a little bit sick, and I felt tense in my chest. At first, I was resisting it, wishing it wasn't like that. But then luckily, in that moment, I remembered the technique. I observed it. Oh, do the Vipassana. And I observed it, and I felt it, and that's 50% of it. Observe. The other 50% is to accept. It's to be like, okay, I'm anxious, and that's okay. So you don't add that layer of stress to it. I'm angry right now. That's cool. And it's cool because you know it's going to pass. Every time you've been angry before, it's passed. All that stress that you had about something, whenever it was, it didn't last forever. And so you know whatever that is in that moment, there's no need to give it all that attention and really, really fight it and wish it was gone. Because if you had a timer counting down until it was gone, you'd say, oh, it'll probably be gone in 5 minutes. But it'll be gone in 10 minutes or 20 minutes, depending on how long you resist it. Some people dwell in that for days. Days, anger, and then they're like, oh, I'm still holding on to that, and then let it go, right? But that's the technique. It's 50% observing what is happening in your body, observing the physical sensations, especially in those high intensity kind of situations. When you're talking about this with your family members, for example, you're observing what's happening in your body and you're just accepting it. It's okay, this is uncomfortable, it's okay. You feel it. And what you learn from that is that it is impermanent, it will pass. And if you let it pass without resisting, without giving it all that negative energy, next time when it comes, that anger comes, instead of dwelling on it for 20 minutes before you go, oh yeah, do that thing, it might be 15 minutes, and then you go, oh yeah, remember, I can do that thing. And if before it felt like a 9 out of 10 intensity, very anxious, very stressful, if you faced it before, next time when it comes, it's like surfing. If you've surfed a 6-foot wave, or let's say 9, if you've surfed a 9-foot wave the first time, it's going to be scary. But if you've surfed a 9-foot wave over and over and over again, after a while, it's chilling. You know what I mean? So it's like if this intensity of this negative feeling is a 9 out of 10 at first, when you keep accepting it and letting it be, the 9 out of 10, it's an 8 out of 10, 7 out of 10, it lasted 20 minutes before, now it's 19, 18, 17. That's the theory behind it. It's the technique. The story goes that the Buddha discovered to fully liberate us from suffering. I don't know, I wasn't around when Buddha was figuring it all out, no. But in my own experience of practicing this technique over and over again for hundreds or probably over 1,000 hours now, I can tell you that probably nothing has benefited me more. In fact, I always say veganism is for the animals. That's what they deserve. And Vipassana is the gift for us. Or meditation is the gift for us. Because it liberates us from our own suffering. And a lot of the suffering we have is self-created. That is, some of you probably is like, what the hell did you just say? Let me say before I say one more thing, that meditation is not some weird hippie religious thing. Just like if you want to get stronger biceps, you go to the gym and you do bicep curls. It has a particular set of benefits. If you do meditation, if you practice this mind exercise, your mind will be strengthened in certain ways. The ways are that you don't ruminate in negativity as much, you feel more peaceful, you feel more compassion, feel more love. It's all the things we want more of and less of all the things that we don't want. But that's how meditation helps you. So I reckon we just infuse it down, and practice it. 2 minutes, 2-3 minutes, something like that. Just practice observing it, do it together, and then we'll end it. We'll probably all feel a little bit more chill, or maybe something will come up and someone's going to be stressed. Nah, pat the person on the side, you'll be okay, it'll pass. So let me just remind you one more time what it is, okay? In a minute, I'll ask you, you don't have to if you don't want. It's worth experiencing that. In a minute, we'll close our eyes, and all you do is just sit there, and I'll run you through it. I'll tell you exactly what to do. So just sit there, relax, observe your breathing, and we'll go through it. Sound good?
Yeah.
All right. Sit comfortably, relax. I'm going to close my eyes, so don't worry, I'm not looking at you. Okay, I'll just start by breathing normally, not trying. trying to breathe deeply, you're not trying to breathe fast, it's just observing your natural breath. So observing the sensation of your breath. What you'll notice is that your mind wants to do pretty much everything but that. It wants to think about this, it wants to think about that, it wants to take you away. And just like the bicep curl analogy, every single time you bring your focus back to this exercise, back to observing your breath, that is you doing one repetition. So just bring it back every time it wanders off. As soon as you're aware your mind has wandered, come back to observing your breath. Scan the body from the top of your head to the tips of our toes just once. So start by putting your awareness to the top of your head and observing what sensations are happening, what physical sensations are there. Maybe it's itchy, maybe it's damp, maybe it's cold, maybe there's pain. Whatever it is, observe and just accept. If it feels uncomfortable, just accept it. Don't wish it wasn't there. If it feels good, just accept it. Don't want it to stay, because it will also pass. Move your awareness down the front of your head, down your forehead. Just slowly observing the physical sensations. Maybe it's tingly, maybe sort of vibration. Moving down to your eyes, down to metta meditation, which is the loving kindness meditation, where instead of observing what's going on inside, you focus on pouring goodness from inside to the outside. So let's put our attention into the middle of our chest. I'm going to say just a few little things, little positive things. And if you want to say after me, you can just repeat what I say. And if you don't feel comfortable, that's fine too. And while I say it, just, let's just continue breathing and observing the sensation in our chest. And imagine just pouring out good energy to all beings. And if you like, repeat after me. May all beings be free.
May all beings be free.
May all beings be respected.
May all beings be respected.
May all beings be liberated from their suffering.
May all beings be liberated from their suffering.
May all humans go vegan.
May all humans go vegan.
Say better.
Okay.
Alright, just opening your eyes. Cool. Okay. Thanks everybody for trying that out. Yeah, give yourselves a clap. Really simple technique. So simple, but kind of also the hardest thing to do, to quieten your mind, to keep it focused on something. But that technique, I promise you, has changed my life at least as much as becoming vegan has. And we all know what a life transforming experience that is. The reason why it's also really important to meditate, I don't know if this is actually true, but this is a study that I read about when they got a huge group of people from all over the world to do a group meditation over about 4 days, I think it was, in Washington, D.C., which is one of the highest crime capitals in the USA. They did an extended meditation in a large group, and the violent crime incidents actually dropped over those 4 days in an unusual way. There's a lot of, you know, conversation about thoughts being, in a way, real, like a tangible thing, a tangible energy. Our energy, we are created by energy. That's what we all are. And, you know, that it matters what we put out there, what we have inside and what we put out there. And I always think, whether it's real or not, obviously I can't tell you 100%, but I always think that a large group of people, especially a group of vegans, meditating together and putting an energy out there that all beings should be at peace and liberated from suffering, I like to think that it does something positive, and if not, at least it feels good for the practice while we're doing it together. So thanks everybody for trying that out, and definitely something that you could continue practicing, even if it's just when you wake up for 10 minutes or when you're waiting in line and you're feeling stressed, you can just observe whenever it is. And the more you practice, the more benefit you'll get. I really don't have too much else to say apart from thank you all so much for being here. Thank you for organizing this event and for everybody for attending, for also your commitment to becoming vegan and staying vegan, and then extending that gift to other people for wanting to know how to do that better. You know, we're all just learning. I'm still learning. We're just trying to help each other do better. That's all I was doing tonight. So I hope that you found something useful from tonight. And let's use what we've learned. Not just know it, but put it into action. Get out there, try something. Step out of our comfort zones. Even if it's just a little bit more out of our comfort zone. Even if you just said one thing that you wouldn't usually say. Even if you just stood up in one moment that you before would have been a little more afraid to stand up and do something. Just practice stepping out of your comfort zone until that area of discomfort becomes your new comfort zone. and then you can step a little more, and that's how you gain confidence in being active in spreading this message to all these people. So thank you all so much for being here, and let's get out there and make it happen. Okay, here's one thing to think about. Sometimes the vegan community can seem like a really toxic place. You got a lot of people in the vegan community suffering from secondary post-traumatic stress disorder, waking up in this nightmare. That's something that people deal with, and they don't know how to channel that. That's definitely one thing. Another thing that is definitely not spoken about enough is people who are in these groups, essentially paid people by industry. I mean, that sounds kind of conspiracy theorist, but that is what happens in movements. That is a known thing that happens, where people are planted in these groups to stir trouble, to create division, divide and conquer. What a great strategy. And it works. And we fall for it. We fall for it because we're not an army, an organized army. We're just a bunch of people who went, whoa, this is bad, we all need to join together and end this. When there's actually people out there who are organized and are professional at creating division in our community. And what can you do about it? Me personally, I don't give that any attention. I see stuff about me all the time. Cool. You guys can all talk about me, whatever you want, but I'm going to just keep doing my job and let my actions speak for themselves. It's hard not to get sucked into the drama, especially when it's you or somebody else you know who is being spoken about, or if it's something like that, which often that's what I see. But, you know, at the end of the day, it's not even about us. It's about the animals. It's about speaking up for them. And I guess I would just recommend those people to remember why they became a vegan activist in the first place. No one wants to be bullied, and that's not right. And, you know, we should speak up against that as well. So, you know, I can't really give you a perfect answer there. There is a lot of infighting. Just remember that a lot of it is, you know, from people who are already suffering. Potentially some of it is from people who are paid to create that division. And, you know, knowing those couple of things helps me not really get involved. I think as well, like, the more attention we give it and we give those people a platform who are doing that, that's wasted energy that could be going to something more productive. But I understand their frustrations, and maybe to them I say, look, okay, you don't want to be part of the community necessarily, especially online. I understand. But still come to the Cube of Truth on the weekend. We've got a vigil tomorrow. Still come to the vigil tomorrow. Still post about it. You don't have to reply to all those comments or whatever. You know. And another thing is, like, sometimes vegans are our worst enemies. Sometimes the vegan movement is the vegan movement's worst enemy. And so again, it'll just be about leading by example and trying to be a bright shining light in a sometimes dark community, even the vegan community. Yeah, I hope that helps. But some things, you know, there's troubles that you wish you didn't have. That it's like, come on, we'll just work together and make this happen. But unfortunately, in a group of so many different ideas and different people and this and that, it's bound to happen. I would also suggest that, you know, what I've seen over and over again is that it happens, there's this storm, and then it just blows over. You know, and just people forget about it, and so I should just keep going, just keep doing it, keep putting out the content, keep going to the actions, and just be a part of it. And you know, and if it's something that you're suffering from specifically, your own mental health, it's okay to take a break. It's not all on any individual's shoulders, it's on all of us. And that's why it's okay. If you need to take a break, you should. Don't burn out. You should take a break. If you're not handling it well at some point, okay, do what you've got to do. but as well, just remember what's happening and come back if there's something possible. Yep.
Do you have any tips for preparing us to see Dominion tomorrow?
Dominion, yeah, I got a tip. Bring everybody you can. It was the most powerful movie I've ever seen in my life. Just be prepared for 2 hours of your own personal torture, to be honest. It was so bad. It was so, so bad. It was things I'd never seen before. It was on a big screen. It was very high definition footage. It was...
noises?
Yeah.
Lots of noises.
Lots of sound. And non-stop, 2 hours long.
What was the reaction to people in the audience? I imagine a lot of them maybe crying, did some leave?
I actually didn't see that many people leave.
Yeah.
I think I saw one or two people leave. I think a lot of people probably shed tears. I was one of them at the end there. And I mean, a better thing to talk about is how motivated I was since that. You know, like it's a really good reminder. The biggest reminder I got, the biggest thing I got from it was, wow, this happened to these animals just the other day, maybe a couple of months ago, or maybe even just a few months ago, whatever. That just happened to them here. You know, that was a really powerful reminder for me. I've always been like, there's enough footage out there, you know, but nah, like that actually really was a point for me personally. So it definitely help bring back some perspective. Sometimes you get caught up in all that crap, all that drama. You know, we're human, like it's easy to get caught up in that stuff. It just reminded me, forget it. Who cares about that? Who are these people talking crap? They obviously don't care. You know, or they don't get it, or whatever. I'm not even going to try to figure that out. But the point is that watching that is guaranteed to light something in everybody. It was extremely intense, yeah. I'll tell you a couple more things just quickly. What was better about it than Earthlings? It was very much like Earthlings. It was very much exact like Earthlings. Pigs, tail docking, and then castration, and this and that. It was set up very much the same way, but it was crisp footage. It was 4K cameras. It was drone footage. It was more entertaining to watch because of the editing. You know what I mean? So it was more like there was that part of it, and then it added just a little bit on health, just a little bit on environment, just to cross those objections off, which wasn't done in Earthlings. And the ending was so powerful. The ending was like really just drove it home. I'd love to say it's such a good quote, but I'm not going to do it. It's so good. I'm like, why didn't I even think of that? It's a genius. I was saying to Chris, like, you're a genius, man. And what else is cool about it is there's a few narrators, so it keeps it more interesting, you know, not just Joaquin's voice the whole time. It was a woman, and then it was Chris, and then it was him. So yeah, everyone needs to watch it. I mean, if you can, obviously, if you're highly traumatized by things like that, then don't. But wow, really, really moved something in me. And you know, any non-vegan who watches that, wow, they're gonna be shook 100%. Yeah.
How do we get them to watch it?
That's a great question. That's a great question.
Yeah.
This is what I would do. Depending on who you're talking to, let's say you wanted your mum to come watch it, because often mum and dad, they're the hardest people to get to go vegan for some reason. I would just put it to them like this, or anybody in general, be like, hey, there's this documentary just coming out, and if this is someone close to you, right? It's supposed to be a really, really powerful documentary. It's a lot of first ever seen footage. It's really well edited, well created movie. And it's all Australian footage. Now, I'll be honest with you, it's not going to be that easy to watch, but it's apparently really, really worth seeing. Really a powerful experience to watch it. And I'd be so grateful if you would come and watch it with me. I'm not trying to force you to do anything. I'm not saying you have to come and then you have to change. You know, I'm vegan. I'm not saying that. I'm just saying I think you'd really probably... be glad that you came if you watched it, you know, and even if for no other reason, just so you can understand me a bit better, just so you can understand where I'm coming from a bit better, you know. you know, I talk about this all the time, it's probably annoying. If you come and watch this, you'll get why I talk about it, and I'm not saying you need to do anything. All I'm inviting you to do is come and sit next to me while I watch this documentary. Would you be down to do that while you're feeding meal beforehand? That's probably how I put it. I just be like, you know, something like that. Or another opportunity would be like, yo, you said this stuff doesn't happen in Australia. There's this documentary coming out. It's coming, it's out tomorrow or whatever. It's so powerful. It's all Australian stuff. I know you think it doesn't happen in Australia. Let's watch it and see what's actually going on, you know? Like, I mean, there's probably a few angles you could go, but I'd always try to come from a place of, like, encouraging, hey, this is going to be a really good thing, and we should definitely watch it. It's powerful. There's nothing like this out there. I've heard so many amazing things. It changes people. Let's check it out. You know, bribe them if you have to. Okay, yeah, one more question. Sponsors set up so that any vegan who wants to be a full-time vegan activist, here's your wage and they'll hook you up. I wish it was like that. I hope one day something like that will exist. Me personally, I created a speech. I offered it for free, which I still do. I've never charged a dollar for my speeches. I've done over a few hundred now, I think. I've got something, right? I'm probably not a great example, to be honest. Okay, I'll just tell you what I did, and then I'll probably tell you better advice. So I had this speech to give for free, and in the meantime, I lived in my van, which is probably not that practical for a family or anything, but I was by myself at the time, and I offered my time for free as long as someone would pay for my expenses, just as in just my travel expenses mainly. I still probably most of the time pay for my own food. Then what I started doing was I started making t-shirts, which I would sell at my events, at the end of a speech, for example, something like this. I'd have t-shirts out there, felt like this, and that's what kept me going for a long time. I just recently, like days ago, started a Patreon page. A Patreon page, for those who don't know, is a way where people who appreciate your work and support your work, they can give you a few dollars or $100, whatever people want to do. Each month, it's a monthly donation that comes out, and that's something more that you can utilize when you have more people who are following your work. And to get to that point, I guess you have to kind of put yourself out there regularly and prove yourself and have people who want you to be able to keep going, because some people can't be activists, but they can donate enough, as much as a cup of coffee once a month to you, to help you be an activist. I don't have a great answer for you. I don't know. I wish I did. I mean, to be a full-time activist, what you could do is try to find a job that enables you to do it. So, for example, there's certain jobs like the SAVE movement. Certain people get paid to create SAVEs, vigils all over the world, and that could be a way for activists to earn an income. If you want to do speeches, maybe you could get paid. If you are selling t-shirts, obviously you're going to get money that way, and that's good activism. If you're going to open a cafe, you're going to get paid that way. So it's a tough one, though. Like, it's been tough for me, for sure. It's been really tough, and especially when you do have commitments and family and things like that. And to be honest, at this point, I don't have a good answer, because the way I did it is probably a very impossible way for most people, living in a van, doing things for free, you know, so, and people don't have a following like I have built now, so I'm sorry, I don't actually have a great answer for that. I wish I could just say, this sponsor, he sponsors everyone who wants to be a full-time vegan activist. I wish that existed. So that's the best I can give you, and hopefully one day I have a better answer for it. Yeah. Okay, I think that's all we've got time for. Thanks everybody, it's been great.
Keep you for a moment longer. said before, we have, you know, you can get involved at stalls, you can get involved in outreach, you can get involved in investigations, so there's lots of different ways. There's also vigils. Please don't turn up at 8 a.m. at JBS tomorrow. Sorry. We have, if you are interested in coming along to tomorrow's vigil, come and talk to me. So we have an off-premises meeting area, and yeah, it's all very covert. But
my bad.
But if you are interested, please come along tomorrow, because we actually we have a really big number. We're probably going to break a record tomorrow, so we want as many people there as possible. That's about it. Oh, if you're interested in getting involved in Cubes, Lisa here runs AB in Brisbane, so I'll just give her a shout out as well.